Thank you very much for this introduction. Thank you also for this connection with the discussion of yesterday. The link between culture, nutrition, and health. That's exactly the topic that we will speak about this morning. It's a small discussion organized a little bit since morning. I will speak for 30 minutes just to give some idea of the topics, and after we have decided to open a discussion on different topics of the possible cooperation between social science and nutrition. So, let me start just with a short introduction. I am anthropology, but my main topic is food habits and the connection between food and health. So, in Toulouse, in CNRS, I'm affiliated to the University of Toulouse and to Taylor's University in Malaysia. In Toulouse, I am co-leader of the axis called Santal. Santal means something is health and food. In CERTOC, CERTOC is a mixed unit research of CNRS. And in Taylor's University, I'm the chair of food studies. And we have set up between Toulouse and Taylor's University, under the auspice of CNRS, an international associate laboratory called Food, Culture and Health. So, you can see some books. I work a little bit on obesity, on the cultural aspect of food, and this book is in English. It's here for you to access. That's a presentation of the topics and the theory about sociology and anthropology of food. So, let me start with this, this data. Very simple data. By a colleague from Montpellier, and you can see around the different category of food. You can see the cereals, the roots, the pearls, fruit and vegetable, vegetable oil, animal fat, meat and eggs, dairy products, fish, sugar and honey. And have a look with this very simple data. Very simple data built on the availability at the level of the state. How we can see a very big difference between the culture. If we compare, for example, the situation in Japan, have a look at the quantity of fish they are eating. Compared to Portugal, even if in Portugal they eat a lot of fish. If I go to Rwanda, the situation is absolutely different. So we can begin to understand that behind this choice, yes, the environment is important. We eat what nature allowed us to produce, not only give to us, because we change the nature by producing food, but also we have cultural choice. And that's the matter I would like to explore this morning with you. I will begin by the end, giving my key message as a conclusion, so you can leave after this slide if you want. I'm looking, so. So, I have three key messages. The first one is food is a multifunctional matter. Biological, you know that very well. But also, social matter, also cultural matter, also hedonic matter. And the way to have pleasure with food is very different from one culture to another culture. It could be the signature of a culture. And food not only fulfills biological needs, but also participate to build and to maintain cultural and individual identities. That means eating what we decide to eat, it's a way to build your cultural identity. When a baby born in a at work, he comes in a food world. You don't decide to like that or that, you learn to laugh, like you learn a language. You arrive in a food world framed by the culture. Means food style are a part of the cultural system. That means through food habits, we transmit the core value of a society from one generation to another generation. It's why it's so important. It's why the family meal or a meal you spend, you have with your friend in a restaurant is a social event. And during this social event, you share value, you transmit value, and you build a link, social link, between you and the different people. So, that's why also the food culture are different all over the world. It's amazing to see all the food culture can be so interesting, so different, sometimes compatible. You can match it and you can go easy to eat and to discover the culture of other people. And sometimes it's not so easy because of the taboo, because of your taste don't allow you to go and to try something. So that's the second idea I would like to develop. The third idea is the question of the challenge. Yes, we have some nutritional challenge. That's right. And you know that very well. We have the challenge of food security. We have the challenge of the quality of food, nutritional quality of food. And we need to continue in this, with this challenge. But to, in order to achieve this challenge, we must have in mind that the quality of food, not only the nutritional quality, that means the symbolic quality, the meaning of the food, is connected with the well-being. And how we can match, how we can articulate quality, nutritional quality, and food quality. So it opens some interdisciplinary research or discussion. The first one is, okay, with modernization of the society. And in this part of the world, you are living that some theoreticians call the compacted modernization. That means you are living in terms of urbanization, in terms of changing of the lifestyle, what in Europe we did in one century and a half, and you are living that in two or three decades. That means the time to adapt, the time to face the change is absolutely not the same. And the big challenge is a non-communicable disease. The big challenge is the development of obesity. And how we can understand the transformation of the food habits. How we can understand the social, economical, cultural drivers of this transformation. Because yes, you take decision. I decide eat something or not. But the cultural environment, the concrete environment where I eat, the organization of the the working time, the transportation, all that have an influence on the transformation of your food habits. So we can see that there is a connection with policy at the level of, yes, health policy, but also education policy, but also agriculture policy, but also environment and urbanist policy. And so food habits is impacted by different dimensions of the organization of the society. And at the end of the day, the question of health is here. So the second interdisciplinary challenge, issue, and opportunity to work is the challenge of food security. And to have a better understanding of the food culture is a way to understand that it's a change. It is a chance that people don't eat the same thing. Because of that, we have not all the, our eggs in the same basket. Because with the transformation of the climate, with certain transformation and risk, political risk, perhaps we can face some problem of food security. I will go a little bit deeper in this direction. And the fact that we have different food model is really a chance and an opportunity. And we need to have a better knowledge about that. The third question is, okay, when we know concretely the food culture, we can frame, we can write, we can send better message in public health and in nutrition. Rooted, connected, adapted, articulated to the food culture. Not only giving advice in general, but applicable advice in the real life, in the concrete life. And the concrete life for food is not only an individual choice, it's a part, whole part individual. But also, you eat in the family, people prepare food for you, and so this question is more complex. And I will finish by some methodological question. Methodological question, we face all nutritionists, epidemiologists, anthropologists, sociologists, we face the same problem. How we can collect good data? How we can collect good data? And when we ask somebody, what did you eat yesterday for lunch? And if the person yesterday don't eat what she used to eat, it's very uncomfortable for her. What will be the right answer? May I have to answer what I did yesterday, but I know it's not exactly what I used to do? Or may I answer what I used to do? But if I have people who don't give the same answer, at the population level, what I see is disconnected with the reality. And it's a common problem we have for data collection. And I would like, after, open a little bit this box to see how we can perhaps share our experience to try to improve the quality of the data collection. So you can see big challenge, but also small technical challenge for the research, for the everyday life of researcher collecting data and trying to improve that. Okay, so that's the lecture is finished. It was a candy series. Now we can start. Okay, let me start with this idea. Food or a meal is a social event. What that means? You know that a meal is a nutritional event. I will incorporate in my body some nutrients and, you know, the importance, and so on. But it's not only that. For this social, we are invited by somebody, and we are happy. And we are happy to share. And I invite you to serve you again. And we... So, sometimes, we are fighting. A meal is also, as a family, a place where we discuss, a place where we educated the children. And sometimes there is some pressure. That's a social event, with all the scope of positive events, and sometimes less positive events and negative events. And that's a connection. So, and food studies will see how the social, the cultural matter influence the meal. Could you imagine the organization of the society to produce food? We don't produce food to feed people, we produce food to have the food that people want to eat. What that means? That means that what is the first is the cultural definition of food. And sometimes, with the evolution of the knowledge of the modern science, we can have discussion between the tradition and the new knowledge. And we can sometimes revisit, transform a little bit the tradition. Just to show you in a very simple way how, where we can find social dimension. That's a way to present a research on food culture and heritage. So you can see the food, the traditional food knowledge. There is a lot of knowledge. Even knowledge about the connection between food and health in the traditional culture. There is some belief about food. Belief about food, belief about the practices. There is a social context to eat food. There is a retail context. How we sell food and it's very different. And the evolution of supermarket changed life and the way to buy food. How to dispose, how to eat, how to shop. All that could show that the food culture is everywhere in the society. Let me go in a more theoretical approach of this question. And I would like to introduce the idea of food social space. That means what is determined by social and cultural aspect in food. First, the human being have to face two constraints. The first constraint is physiological and biological constraint. In a few words, we are not able to synthesize certain amino acids. You know that. And the quality of the protein is different. Some proteins have not enough certain amino acids, like lysine or tryptophan. So, we need to have a good balance between amino acids at the same time when you eat. But there is many solutions to do that. You can eat animal products, you can eat eggs, you can eat meat, you can eat fish, you can eat dairy products, but you can also combine some plant protein that are like pearls, that have an excedent of certain amino acids, and combine with wheat, with a CER that have excedent of other amino acids, and you can have a good balance. And what is a formidable, amazing discovery of the traditional culture is to have discovered in different parts of the world the way to supplement the amino acid without any knowledge, only empirical knowledge. So what I said? I said that the physiological and biological constraints are we need amino acid, but where we can find amino acid, we are free. That's why certain cultures decide to don't eat pork, to don't eat beef, to don't eat meat, and that have no effect. You must be careful with certain forms of vegetarianism, for vitamin B, for example, or iron, but you can. We have a room of freedom to choice, and that's because of this room of freedom, the culture can use food without consequences on the nutritional dimension and use that for cultural matter. Let me give you another example. We are not able to stock certain nutrients, mainly the micronutrients. And so we need to have to get it on a regular basis. Some of them every day, like C vitamin, other one more regular, less regular, sorry. We need sometimes to have at the same time some micronutrients to be able to assimilate. So we need calcium, but we can have calcium in different kind of food, in dairy, in certain water, in certain food. So again, a room of freedom. I don't continue, but we can say the same with the fat and the fat acid. So, what is the first lesson? We have some constraint, and the nutrition learns that better and better. And our knowledge is good. Even we are the day before of a strong revolution in science with epigenetics. I will give some word about that. On the other side, we have ecological constraints. That means, if I'm living in the desert or in the jungle, it's not the same environment. It's not so easy to produce in certain environment. It's easier in other ones. Water, no water, sun, not sun, temperature, all that have an influence, really. But at the same time, the evolution of the history of man on this question is a knowledge that has taken away this influence. We have learned to conserve food by deep freezer, by canned food, by dry food. We have developed a lot of technology to make the distance between the ecological constraints. And we have learned also to change the environment, to make it more productive. So that makes it open new questions, new issues. So, but we have a room of freedom. So in this room of freedom, the culture use this room to develop identity and individual and cultural identity. Where we can do that? On the range of foods that in a culture you consider as eatable. In certain culture we eat dog, in other culture we don't. In certain, we eat pork, in other one, we don't. Beef, no beef. Horse, no horse. And so on. So the range. But it's also true for vegetable. I love pad thai. Pad thai is yes, you know that. But some people, some French people, cannot eat pad thai. I love chili. But also, chili is a cultural marker. So, food system, the food organization, the way to produce food, and the society, rural society versus a modern society, it's defined also by what people want to eat. The culinary aspect, I try to go faster. The food pattern, the consumption, the meal, the kind of the meal, the kind of meal, with a starter, main course, dessert, or the Chinese meal with all the meal on the table. The way to eat with the hand, with the fork, with the chopsticks, the time to eat, when I eat, all that are defined by culture. You know, if I compare the way to eat, the time to eat of a French and the Spanish people, we have a friend in Barcelona and we collaborate in research with them. We don't eat absolutely not at the same time. And we are living in Europe, we are at the same development level, we are, and we work together. But they eat at 3 p.m. For the lunch, and we eat at 12 in France. So when we go to in Barcelona to cooperate, we arrive at 11, and for us, at 12, we begin to be hungry, and we have to wait, and the same for them. When they arrive, we go to eat 1 hour after. So, that's a social differentiation between the social hierarchy, with the gender, with the religion, all that have an influence, and it's used by the society to build identity. And also, some political matter, and there is some debate, some discussion in the world trade with what we can sell, what is open. So the definition is also political. So when I say that, we can begin to think the interaction between social and biological also. Because some choice can have, some cultural choice can have an influence on physiological aspect. Let me give you only one example. With the epidemiological transition that have made change, the reason to die from epidemic to non-communicable disease, cardiovascular disease and cancer. Certain food choice we have made in the past, for example, the fat. The choice of the fat was in the past a cultural choice. If you do a map of France, you have people who eat butter, people who eat duck fat, people who use olive oil, and for many years it was a cultural differentiation. If I pass away at 50 years old with an epidemic, no problem, I can choose what I want. But with the life expectancy increasing, if I pass away at 80, 90, with a cardiovascular problem, this choice can be reviewed with modern knowledge. And we can have a look of the tradition. At the same time, the epigenetic is open a fantastic room of cooperation between sociocultural matter and nutritional matter. I will go that. I will finish by that. Our friend Japanese, the Japanese love a little. This is very big animal living in sea.
Whale.
Yes, in French it's baleine. Okay, then it's a big problem. I will take another example. In China, they like shark feed. And so with the emergence of a middle class in China, is a big problem for the shark. But not only for the shark, because the shark have a place in the ecosystem. And we can see how a cultural decision can, in certain situations, have a global problem. So let me go on the epigenetic. The epigenetic, a few years ago, was working on two dimensions, nutrigenomic and nutrigenetic. The influence of food on the expression of gene, and the expression of gene and the consequence on food. But after the second stage of genome, we have discovered the epigenetic layer and the methylation of gene that can block or open the expression of a gene, like a system on-off to put the light or stop the light. And what happened with this question? In fact, there is a connection, a strong connection between the food habits and the epigenetic matter and the expression of your gene. Let me open very simply, and we can discuss more if you want. But at the scale of the generation, what the generation have eaten have an influence on the available gene in the population. That means the gene that you have in your population was selected for a part by the food system. Meat, no meat, alcohol, no alcohol, chili, no chili, all that can have an influence. The second is probably the most important. The influence of what the mother eats on the health of the baby during his life. Not the right after the birth, but at long-term influence. And the knowledge begins to be produced now with certain window of opportunity, the influence of emotion, the influence of the food. And nutrigenomic analyzes the influence of what you eat during your life and the influence on the expression of your genes. So, for the first time in the history of science, we will have empirical data to discuss between culture and biology. That's a revolution. It will take time. I don't know if we will have efficient knowledge in 5 years, in 10 years, or in 15 years. But the window is open now. And there is a fantastic need to have a better knowledge on the food culture to open the dialogue. So, I finish what I would like to say as an introduction. And before we open the question, I just would like to give some word about some research challenge we try to develop in this part of the world through the ASEAN food barometer and the question of the protein transition. Okay, what is a barometer? You have the traditional nutritional survey focus on the food consumption in terms of category of food, in terms of nutrients, and in terms of variety. That's very important matter. And the traditional nutrition survey tried to introduce the question of eating behavior and the question of sensorial analysis. We are working on the side of food culture, trying to understand the concrete context of eating. Means where people are eating, in, out. What is the system? Who cook? Is it the family? Or I buy food outside? And you can see the different culture is so different. If I buy food, I don't control the fact, I don't control how to produce the food. So a part of the decision is not in my hand. If I cook at home, depending if who cook for who. And we can see in this case, it's a family question. And we not only need to train the individual, but we need to train the family, and we need to train people working in restaurants, in food service, and in a country like yours, with all the sweet food, it is a big challenge. It's a big challenge. So the second is the food index, how it's organized, culturally speaking, food representation, and the different way to perceive the risk with food. Food safety, but also risk, nutritional risk. So, in fact, a food barometer works at this level. And it's really a complementary data for the traditional nutritional survey. The objective is to open an interdisciplinary dialogue and research to serve public health. Our objective is to be useful to society, not only to produce beautiful knowledge and put in the cabinet in my office, to be proud of and have a good article in a peer review with high impact factors. It's important, but it's more important, it's very important to be useful to the society. So, studies food pattern, complementary data for nutritional survey, open multidisciplinary. Few words about this question. This conceptual framework was developed for Malaysia. In Malaysia, you have ethnic groups. Malay people, not very far from Indonesian people in terms of culture, but some difference. Chinese people, Indian people, and some other groups, mainly in Sarawak and in Sabah, in Borneo, Iceland, you have some ethnic groups with different cultures. So, but Malaysia have known very strong urbanization in a few years. First time I went in Malaysia, in 86, it was a rural country. Now, the level of urbanization of Malaysia is the average level of Europe. Emergence of middle class. Same, in 3 decades, you have people in middle class with one car, 2 cars, living in good condition, and it changed the way the lifestyle. So demographic transition. Former extended family, 2-3 generations under the same roof, taking care of the children with a generation, gathering the income, going to a couple, 2 children, and you have this transformation of the society, the transformation of the birth rate, and you have the stylization of the consumption. So all that are main trends in the society. On the other side, people decide something. But they are influenced by these factors and influenced by the context where they decide. Restaurant or not, and so on. So I finish this part with a challenge. The scientific challenge is this one. Perhaps you heard about the convergent modernity. In terms of food, what that means? That means if I have, you see, all that is a country, and we analyze the evolution of the relation between the calorie coming from animals and the evolution of the total calorie per person. What we can see over the time, the quantity of calorie in a lot of countries increased. And the share of the animal product increase. And behind that, there is a problem for health, and there is a problem for food security. So, that's what we see at this level, at the macro level, in fact, is different. Yes, we have these trends, and the FAO considers that for the food policy. And at the macro level is true. But please, when we go at the level of the state, the situation is different. And look, this arrow. This arrow is a country. And this arrow is another country. So all the countries don't go at the same speed and the same way. That means the transformation of food habits is driven not only by economical factors, it's driven by cultural factors. And there is a signature for each country. It's a way to move. For example, when in India people get more money, they eat more dairy products, they eat more chicken, they eat more eggs. But because of religion, because of vegetarianism for some of them, they don't eat beef or not so much. And there is a way to move. If we compare with China, when Chinese people get more money, they eat more pork, they eat more beef. And so evolution is not the same. So that is what we call the protein transition. Try to understand how people change the kind of protein that they are using. So, and the idea is to develop a network. There is a network in Europe working with quite the same methodology, and we try to develop one in Asia, and that is the purpose of the LEA of CNRS, the International Associate Laboratory, to try to develop some partnership to extend this methodology to focus on the transformation of the food habits and to focus on the economical, sociological, anthropological, cultural driver of this transformation. Thank you very much for this first part. Now, I'm open to answer your question. I hope my English, my rustic English, was not an obstacle for you to understand what I tried to explain. But we can discuss and it will be easier to go more in detail.
Any issue to address? Burning points? Yes, introduce your name and your problem.
Hello, my name is Amy. I have two questions. My background is public health. I have two questions. The first one is actually unnecessary, but I need to know. Like the first slide, you mentioned about the Japan and comparison of the countries. I'm just curious. Can you show us the picture again? Does that mean also Japan eats less than other countries?
You?
my question is, from that picture, does this also imply that Japan is less than other countries because, you know, the area is smaller than others? Is it also, is like that information?
I'm not sure to understand the picture.
The image
is referring to whether that small area, the small area in
implies
consumption.
Thank you. You can see the scale is not the same. And because the consumption of fish is so high, the scale, have a look, if I compare the scale, it's not the same.
I see.
In fact, that's why. We cannot think in terms of area. Okay? And perhaps I can give you another way to understand. You see the brown, that's the average of the Western consumption. And the black is the average of the world consumption. So if you compare, for example, Japan, you see what is brown. You can see where they are above and where they are below the average consumption of the Western country. If I compare France, I can see where France is below, for example, for sugar and honey, but where France is for animal fat, dairy product, fish product, but below for fruit and vegetable. So it's also a tool to understand the difference. Yes.
Oh, thank you. That's very interesting. Okay. Can I have one more question?
Sure.
My other question is about the protein changing. Like you mentioned about the like how countries have like you know like cultural identity itself like it's different to each other. My question is how we can define. Each country to, you know, to focus on what is kind of the problem that make it change it?
Okay, that's a fantastic question. Can I suggest something? We can perhaps try to gather two, three questions, and I will try to build an answer for all. Is it possible?
Yes, it's possible.
Thank you, your question is very good.
Thank you for your available information. We know that food is multi-function. Yeah, we agree that it's complicated. My question is, we know that because so many common factors influencing the pattern of food consumption and others, so from your point of view, would it possible that a culture-related food can be solved in the short term? Because so many, as you mentioned before, so many influencing factors, so, and what is the most strategic way or approach so that, because we are facing the problem on resources, so what is this, for us as developing countries, what are the most strategic approach that we can deal with?
Yeah. So thank you very much. Another one for us?
I have a question.
Thank you. My name is Mosalina from Stetson University, Jakarta. And my question is, you mentioned earlier that challenge and opportunities is methodological to collect data. It's linked to food and nutrition. So what do you think about positive defense inquiry to as methodological to collect data on the normal nutrition status among malnutrition children? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. So I think we can. There is a sentence of. It was a French politician, but it was General de Gaulle. He was also a military guy. And he said, we cannot do politics without reality, without knowing the reality. And I would like to take this question. In fact, one of the most interests of taking in account and understanding the question, socio-cultural dimension of food, the most interest is because it opens the window of the reality of the life. And the way, the world in which people take the decision, the world in which people act. And so we need to take a place in this reality. So what that means? In fact, it's open different question, methodological question, theoretical question, and strategical question. So I will take 20 minutes to try to answer these different dimensions and allow me to start with the methodological question. Because it's something that we do every day as a researcher, and we face some problem, and we face some common problem. I would like to start okay, the main problem we face, the sociologist, but nutritionist also, is to be sure that people say to you blah 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 blah, have a connection with what they do. And we must be sure that what they say is not built for you to make you happy. You know, when we do a survey with children, it's very difficult to do that. Because for them, to make the difference between reporting what they did and answer to the lecturer, the teacher, a good answer, that it's very difficult to make this difference. Even you explain them, at the end they do, it is right or not. So, but with people also, when you have the status of researcher doing an interview or doing a recall, people tell you, but is it true or not? You know that the more relevant data we have on obesity, the consumption of obese people is less than the other one. Everybody is saying it's not possible, but that's the literature. And we publish paper to calculate coefficient of under-reporting of obese people. You know that. That's a way, okay, we can work. They don't answer exactly what they do. So, the interdisciplinary between social science and nutrition open the box of cooperation. And I would like to show you, I would like to introduce this lady. His name is Marine Blas. He's a very important anthropologist of food in UK. And she writes fantastic books, and I'm glad to introduce one called Food in Social Order. And it's really, really a milestone in the history of nutrition and food studies. So, what she said, he said, okay, she wrote an interesting article. She was at home and she would like to finish a paper. The children was turning around, mom would like to eat. And the husband said, okay, and she said, okay, I will prepare something to allow you to wait for a proper meal. She will give something to eat, but it will not be a proper meal, and she will do a proper meal after. But what is it, a proper meal? And she opens a discussion like that. And she shows that a proper meal is something that has a social definition, a cultural definition. And the sociologists, the anthropologists, we call that a social norms. And you know, social norms is very important, because if you transgress the norm, people are not happy around. Let me give an example. A normal meal, a proper meal in France, in the generation of was the first course, the main course, cheese and dessert. And when my father arrived at home, 19 plus years old, asking to my mother what we have for lunch, the question was what we have for starter, what we have for main course, what we have for dessert. And never my mother could imagine to do a lunch without a starter and a dessert. Now people in France, younger generation, it can accomplish. And there is a transformation of this structure. To finish with that, when we have too much heat, for example, for Christmas or for the feast, my mother said, tomorrow we will eat lightly. A little bit of soup, a little bit of meat and vegetable, a little bit of cheese. She was not able to think lightly out of the structure, of the pattern of the meal. So, the pattern of the meal are very important. Why? Because when people try to answer the question, they have that in mind. They have that in mind. And when you ask somebody what you did yesterday, and when he is uncomfortable, he don't like to lie. But he gives to you the social norms. So how we can deal with that? A way to deal consists to ask to people for you, what is a proper breakfast? On a normal day, for you, what is a proper lunch for a normal day? What is a proper dinner or supper? And when they say that, after you can say, okay, now, please, we would like to focus on you, what you did yesterday, on your real practices. And because you have cleaned the mind by asking them to give you the norms, after they are more comfortable to give you what they did. And for example, we have applied this methodology in the barometer of the National Institute of Health Prevention in France, the CNRS, and we do that even by phone, saying to people, okay, we will do in 2 times first, we would like to know what you used to do, what's the normal way for you to do, and please, after now, tell us what happened yesterday. And even yesterday, it was different. Please, let me know what you did yesterday. And when we compare, we can see that it's different. And sometimes, in the data collection, we got more norms than practices. And when you are in a society where the food habits are changing, when you have the norm, you have what they did in the past, not what they do today. So how we can go, methodologically speaking, in depth? Okay, you can see that the data collection in Malaysia, in English, in Chinese, in Bahasa Malaysia, and we ask for a proper meal. But after we have a way to collect, you know, 24 hours we call it, you use it. But have a look. We have several parts, and we will use that per food intake. For example, we will start with, okay, what happened? We will rebuild the day before. What happened when you wake up? So I take a coffee, or I have a juice, or just water. So, and we will follow food intake by food intake. So, where it was? At home? At office? Or outside? And so on. And that's the place. Where comes the food from? was cooked at home, was buried outside, and so on. That's a more classical for you. Okay, what's the name? For example, we don't ask them, what did you do for breakfast? We use for the norms, but not for the food intake. You ask them to give the name. This is food intake, what is it? And it's very interesting. I don't know for Malaysia, for Indonesia, but the history of the country, the colonization, the mix between the vocabulary from Western country and local country, and all that have an influence. And if you ask people what you did for lunch, what you did for dinner, what you did for breakfast, and you analyze the prevalence of in fact, when you do that, there is a part of cultural matter that are parasitic. And I have personally developed some research in French Polynesia, and the number of meals per day are nothing to see in the traditional culture. And we can see that the most obese people are those who are in between two cultures, and they and not. So we can see that this question. So the name, the quantity, the food items, what people have eat themselves, what they have shared, and after the social context went on with the other people, where it was, and so on. So, I'm sure we have a bridge to do. Go in connection with the transformation in nutrients. And let me show you some examples. And let me start with the breakfast. That's data coming from French survey. We asked to the French, you can read it in appetite, because English, the norms for the breakfast. We asked to the French, what is for you a normal breakfast? And you can see 27 answer something close to the British breakfast. That means coffee or tea, bread, butter, but also cheese, ham, fruit. So, 52 answer the French traditional breakfast, the croissant or the bread, and the coffee and jam. Or smaller. And you have 13% said, okay, I just take a coffee or tea or juice. Very simplified breakfast. And other one said, okay, then we produce cereal and so on. That's the norms. Let me go to the practices. When we say what happened yesterday. And what happened yesterday? You remember 27? There are 7. Only 7% of the 27 do a breakfast like the British. But in the north, they are close to that. Probably they would like to do. And we consider that they get the message of nutrition. You need to eat in the morning to avoid a long time and the fall of the glycemic before the lunch. So, have a look. These 52% become 57, but it's not the same. It's not the same people. And please have a look at that. 25% of the French population don't have breakfast. And for the nutritionist, it's an issue. But when we said to people, you have to eat, they said, okay, yes. And a big part of them believe that they eat So when I come to the message and the dialogue between nutrition, public health, and the cultural matter and the transformation, let me show you what we can do with that. We can do a cognitive mapping on that. Have a look, you have the norms here, the Anglo-Saxon norms and the simplified norms, the practices, Anglo-Saxon. Have a look here, here you have the 27 that we showed before, saying I need a breakfast like the Anglo-Saxon style. There are only 6 to do it. 13, eat a traditional breakfast for the French. And 4%, nothing. Just if I would like to give advice to these people, at the individual level, what the global level, if I would like to give advice, no need to explain to these people that they need to eat in the morning. They know, yeah, they will. If you have advice to give to them, okay, try to see why they believe to it is good to do that, and why they don't do. Because there is nothing in the fridge, they need to buy, they need to prepare, they have to go out, and so on. Why they did that? What's the cooperation in the family around that situation? Go to give advice in the concrete living context. But for this one, perhaps you can speak nutrition. What that means? 10% don't eat anything in the morning, and they do. And they consider that little problem. If for these people, we can have a discussion. So we can see that we have to really change. We can change by the knowledge, we change the norm, and we can change by the social context. But this kind of research allows you to identify which category of population is here or here. So, I invite you to read this paper, and you can download it on my research account. You send for the lunch. You have the norm for the French. The norm is a traditional me, like my father, and the reality, have a look, and that first course, second course, cheese and dessert, and have a look, only 30%. The new norm is here. The new norm is a main dish and a dessert. And we need to understand, if I try to do health policy, I need to know that. Why? Imagine I would like to support the consumption of vegetable. For the French, it could be useful. Remember, the first, we are under the consumption. So we can push and say to the French, you need to eat more vegetable and fruit. But the structure of the meal of the French, no starter now. And the desserts are mainly dairy. Well, they will eat fruit. And you need to frame your advice in a taking in our in context the reality of what they do. Okay, so that's a part of my answer. That's a part of my answer, and you can find in this article also some more general reflection on this question, the connection between the cultural factors and the methodological and the strategical factors. Perhaps we can go for another series of questions? Or questions on the same topic if you want, if I don't answer clearly.
Okay. Yeah, I think they have a burning question, so before it is burned out, let's...
Yeah, sure.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Thank you, sir. This is maybe I'm one of literally missing. Please come here. I'm not disabled actually.
I was thinking maybe you can take off your jacket so that it's. He's from the Air Force.
Actually, I myself from Air Force. My post in the center of military in Jakarta. So maybe I have some question for you, and I've been talking about the food related to anthropologists and also the enemy. Okay, first of all, I want to ask you for the next. We as a team of the Nubica, nuclear biology and chemical, can assume that for the next food as a bioterrorism. Do you agree or not? Again, yes. My question that for the next, not only for the guns, not only for the weapon, for the kill someone, but food is one of the dangerous one. So now we will have the intelligent medical, especially handle how to the biosecurity food. So my question related to your knowledge, anthropologist and food, why for the next people are very dangerous for them? Because they know all human in the world always consume something. If they use the food as the poison, they are as one of dangerous men in the world. How to handle it?
Okay.
The first question. The second about the traditional food and the modern food. Do you know that in our country, especially in ASEAN, for a long time ago, maybe our age is still 100 years ago, 100 years or maybe 80 or 90, because we still use a staple food for the local food. But now in current issue, we choose the modern food like junk food, fast food as a staple food. In this item, we know that especially in military, we have 5 diseases related to the food. The first about the hypertension, heart attack, and also diabetes. They know about that. Why they didn't want to change their habit? My question still, do you have tips why and what should we do for the local food to be as the main item in our country? Yes, yes. Thank you very much for your question.
And thank you very much for your question. So yes, we can go for the question. I keep in mind food as a weapon, and the second one, how we can valorize it,
the
local
food.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, sir. My name is Haldi. Actually, I study psychology too, and then I study about nutrition. My thesis is about intention.
Hello.
Yes, very
good. My name is Haldi. I'm also study psychology. My thesis is about intention of mother who's giving health food for their children.
Also me.
Intention of the mother to give healthy food for their children.
Okay.
It's actually it's determined whether the home is eating the healthy food, and then also I have a lot of. By culture too. My question is about what do you think about that women's role in multi interdisciplinary? You say about when your father pattern, and I think it's your mother who. Well,
decide
at home, so that's
okay.
Just
turn
my
question. Thank you very much for this question. Another one, before we go.
One more question. So, thank you for the opportunity. My name is Ali. My question is really related about Indonesia is a multicultural and multi-ethnic country, and I realized that in some part of Indonesia I haven't developed yet, as like for example Jakarta, and then so about food habit or eating habit, if we want to increase their health and nutritional status, so we give them education about how to improve their eating behavior, right? But in some at some point, culture and ethnicity become constraint to improve that. If, for example, in Papua, so what is your opinion about that and tips to for us to approach this kind of ethnicity of people? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this so interesting question. I will start with food as a weapon. First, food is a tool for war for a long time in the history. We in Europe to make the military around the town and stop the possibilities for the town to get new food was a way, was the first way to stop to the importation of food is always, as we have that, a way that the politician use.
It's like an embargo?
Yes, embargo, absolutely. Thank you for giving me the word. But what you have in mind is more complex. We can have the same problem with water, consuming water. We can have the same with staple food, you are absolutely right. Honestly, it's not a problem that we can solve alone. That's a question that probably the main decision are at the military and political level, and we can try to see with our knowledge, nutrition and anthropological, we can assist to you. But the risk is real. There is a real risk, and not only for state-to-state conflict, could be also a problem with terrorism. And we can have these guys, I hope it will not happen, but it could be a way. But if I look at the history, on the small scale, the poisoning was the tools to kill overfull people. And rounding the king, rounding the aristocrats, people who was people taking care of the food, tasting the food. That's really an important matter. And probably we don't be totally aware of the chance we have to live in a peaceful world food. Can go in the street and eat something, you can have some safety problems, but we control a lot of them. At the scale of the history, this situation is not so common. Not so common. Shortage and poisoning was two main issues. But you are right, and I think it's a good thing that the military takes this question at the agenda, try to understand, and probably we have not to speak too much in public of that. So that's the first point. The second point was the question of local food, and we connect with a different question. How we can promote the consumption of the local food? The first one is to recognize that there is a part of culture inside, and that is more important than food. Because what attracts is junk food is the modernity, marketing, the merchandising. And we need how we can give sense, meaning to the local food. Must not be naive. We cannot, you have about locavore attitude, people who like to eat only what is produced 100 kilometers around them. No, no, probably we need to have a change, but we need to promote more the local food produced by people around us and coming from our culture. That means we are not open to other culture. We can be, but we promote the dimension of this food. And food becomes not only food, it becomes also a cultural event. So the discovery and the work on to establish a connection, to produce a knowledge around the food, not only cooking. Cooking, yes, is important, and to promote the skillness in terms of cooking, but promote the social signification. And how, you know, when you start, you take a certain cultural aspect of culture, and it's all the cultural system that comes. Why people eat cuisine in India? It's not because they cannot pay for a fork and a spoon. They can do. It's not because they cannot use chopsticks. It's a cultural choice. Even people have lost that. Because they used to do like the family do. But in the Indian society, you don't put in your mouth. Something can go in the mouth for somebody else, coming from another caste, another social position. And the definition of what is pure, what is dirty, is also cultural definition. And all that is could be this kind of knowledge allowed to revalorize, change the vision of the local food elements. And we can promote it and be proud of it. So, and becoming proud, I think working on that is a way to make a link with the generation, with the culture, and to anchor the present generation in the historical tradition. But a tradition can change. And sometimes it's useful to make change the tradition. So, the second question about the relation, I will go 5 minutes on the tradition after. The second about the psychological dimension, this dimension is very important. Very important, and you know how, for example, some, how do you call that? Eating disorder could have a psychological dimension. Anorexia, the relation between the mother and the child. What we saw with the epigenetic is that this question could be, oh my god, probably more important than we imagine. There is a psychological dimension that we have to take into account, the way to feed. But I know you work on that. But yes, we need to explore more on this question. You know, the first thing you have with somebody is affection and this food with your mother through the milk and the body to body relation. This relation follow you all over your life, and the connection with food until the end of the life. When all the other sources of pleasure have disappeared, food is still here. The connection with life and the connection with reality. Yes, this part is important. I would like to finish this session on the connection with the food. you can have that one. About the knowledge behind the tradition. Sometimes there is knowledge, sometimes there is mistake. So, how we can imagine the relation between the traditional knowledge and the modern knowledge, the cultural knowledge and the modern knowledge. Okay, there is two ways. The first way is to say, okay, it's disconnected. The culture use the room of freedom given by the biological constraint. You can do what you want. You don't eat that, you eat that, no effect. That's the first way to see it. But we can also imagine that there is behind empirical knowledge some true law, natural law, discovered by the ancestor, by the culture. And we can, with the modern knowledge, go to see that, what I did with the protein before. And we call that ethnoscience. That means how the modern science can have a look on the traditional knowledge. And I can give you some example. Okay, you can have... Okay, no connection. The culture works are working in the room of freedom. But we can have placebo effect. That means I follow the rule of the culture and my level of anxiety, I'm happy, I'm culturally well, and it's enough without any effect on the biological. And now we go on the psychological dimension. You have opened in the discussion. But we can imagine that there is an empirical discovery that we can explain with the modern knowledge. And I think there is some of the traditional knowledge we can explore this way. But we can also think that some empirical discovery done by the tradition are not able to be explained today, but could be explained in the future. And what I have in mind is exactly the question of epigenetics. And the question of digest, the question of allergy. I think there is some question that the science today try to take it into consideration that can be in the future rethink with new paradigm and new vision. Okay, that's the very good example is the protein and amino acid example. You know, when you like, you eat beans and wheat at the same time, you have some lysine, for example, is missing in wheat, but you have more in bean, and when you put together, you increase the performance, the protein performance of the ration, of the diet. A lot of traditional cooking and culture have discovered that. Soya bean with rice, in the pulse with rice or corn and so on. So, and you have a lot. We can, with this model, go to traditional food. So, conclusion, traditional food is culture, but behind culture, perhaps, there is more than culture. And to promote the traditional food, we have an avenue. We promote at the cultural level, need to research to see what is behind, and with some development of science, with epigenetic, perhaps we will have new argument. Thank you very much for your question. It was very interesting and allowed me to answer.
Okay, I think there are some
some points that was addressed still, maybe you can clarify and respond to the role of women on influencing at some point the food practices and dietary pattern that we have, concerning your example. And yeah, the issue with the challenging education in the rural part of Indonesia that is less developed, yet culture may have barriers on the adoption of that education on better practice, for example. So maybe you could also elaborate that response.
Okay, thank you very much. I believe it was, the time was over, so that's why I did a conclusion. But I'm okay to reopen a little bit the discussion. Okay, the role of woman, it's a very, very interesting question. Different layer in the answer. I think in the traditional repartition of the world concerning the food work, what we call the food work is shopping, cooking, organizing the meal, managing the meal because the meal need to manage, cleaning, is very different from one society to another. Even we can see that the women are often on this side. I said in the majority of society, but not totally all. Also, in the level of the society, you can have different things, different organizations. I speak about the extended family, where this world is here, handled by different generations. It's the same also for taking care of the children. And we, if we compare extended family versus nuclear family, the repartition of the role are very different. We can introduce also with the level of society, is there a nanny or not? When we work in Malaysia, different layers of the society, in certain class, but not only at the top, you can have helper, and it changed the role of the mother in the family. So that's the first level. The second level is how the cultural matter frames this question. The image that a mother might have to nourish family is a strong stereotype. And when I say stereotype, there is no negative dimension in my mouth. But I would just like to say that in certain society, some women are fighting against that. And the feminist movement, for example, asks the question why it is the woman who has to do all the work. And claims for more equitable equality in the repartition of the world. So I think this question is not a simple one. It's not a simple one. If I go on a very practical level, I think not going to change the world. And I just take what the situation in one country. When I understand what is the repartition of the role, in a lot of countries, women have in the hand a very important dimension of food. And when I say when you cook, try to make pleasure, try to make them happy, you try to feed them in the proper way. But you have in your hand the health of the family. And if we can disseminate some knowledge, it could be a good thing. But we need to have
a critical vision of our knowledge, and we need to try to see how we can make this knowledge useful. And not a knowledge to make people uncomfortable, because they are not able to apply. That means how we can make it useful. That means, okay, when you speak nutrition, if you speak cooking, that's good. Because in fact, the decision about food are at different level. What I buy, how I organize my meal, and when I organize my meal, I think about tradition, I think about recipes, I think about exchange with people, I think my husband likes that or don't like that, my son likes that or don't like that, and I take it into account, all these dimensions. And it's normal. That's normal, not only nutrition. So we need to embody nutrition in this psychological, sociological, cultural dimension. And practical. So, my husband has cholesterol. How can I help him if I have to cook? It's not only a choice for him, but I can have an influence by my way to cook, the nature of fat I will use. So, and we understand that the person who cooks in the family controls a part of the system, of the quality. So when we speak cuisine, cooking, when we are in nutrition, that's good. That's good. So, after that, I think one of the big challenges in the modernized society and in this part of the world is the fact that the eating out is very high. In Malaysia, 64% of people eat at least one meal per day out of the home. One meal per day. It's very big. And they don't eat like the American in fast food. They go to Mamak, they go to street food. And we have to work with that also. That means there is a, I don't know what word using, probably a social responsibility of this kind of industry. Industry, you understand, I put, it's not really industry, but how we can go to the community and how we can develop empowerment of the, in terms of food, nutrition, but not too complicated. We can select some specific problem, perhaps cholesterol, the using of the fat, for example. Because we have in hand not only the question of the family, but also the question of eating out. What I surprised, I was surprised by something, and I think it's really interesting, is to see when in the society where people eat out oftenly, and the mother gives some money to the children to buy food, and they learn a lot of things. And we need to teach them how to use this money, buy food correctly. And that's quite new for me. Because when I look at this question from the Western point of view, all the programs to fight obesity, focusing on the family, and so on, because the number of meals out is less. And we focus on the food service, we speak with the manager of the food service to see how they can do with seafood and so on. But in your case, I think, and I come back to the mother cooks, the mother prepares the food, the mother manages, but the mother also, and the father probably also can have a role at this level. How we can train children to use the small money to buy the good food. So, and good food means sometimes can be food for pleasure, why not? But also taking a building to them, a vision of food, that's pleasure, that's identity, that's pleasure, but that's the connection with health. That could be the answer. I don't know if I answer the second one.
I think of course the discussion that happens today is like a stimulation for further questions. That's why whatever you have respond, I think creates further thinking. That is why I need to close the session. I think very good and applause for JP. I mean, in conclusion, I think it is clarified earlier in the beginning that all the issues related to what is manifested as nutrition in our nowadays life is actually relies on the lack of our attention on exploring actually the social dimension, socio-cultural dimension that embedded to the manifestation of the nutrition. That calls for the right methodology, the right collaboration, as well as the right segmentation probably on which part of the targets we need to learn. And I would like to invite actually everybody in this room to have a message taken home and then think about what would be the contribution of us as nutritionists on improving the situation of our nutrition in our country. Not to mention also the issue with this nuclear and thing related to that, because bioterrorism even is part of the food concern. So for that, JP is available in any platform of social media. So if you would like to have further question or contact with JP, then you can visit his YouTube channel, his Facebook, he is on ResearchGate if you are into research. So he is available in many platforms. So please contact him further. And then for that, I would like to thank you again on behalf of RECFON.